Okay. Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Very well. Let us now pass to section 3.2, devoted to the building in unstable land. Three presentations are included in the section. The first and the third presentation are related to risk assessment, and the second to the structural monitoring of reinforced concrete building. We will have also a discussion at the end of the three presentation, and the convener is Professor Federica Cotecchia. Well, now I can give the microphone to Dr. Janeschi. Give us a lecture on novel charts for risk assessment of cut slope stability in highly weathered and fractured schist. Please, Dr. Janeschi.
Hello, thank you, Professor. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
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 Oh, okay. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for the opportunity to present a paper on this great event. The paper is titled Novel Charts for Risk Assessment of Cut Slope Stability in Highly Weathered Schists. First, I will define the problem and highlight some research studies investigating this topic in the past. Then the concept of the proposed methodology will be elaborated. This methodology is based on the findings of a case study, a motorway in Macedonia. The idea is to compare the analysis and results with the in-situ conditions of the analyzed cuts and propose reference zones for the level of risk on some novel charts. The slope stability of deep cuts in weak rock formations is a difficult challenge. Even more difficult is to define an acceptable level of risk. The difficulty arises from the geological uncertainties within the rock formations caused by insufficient or inadequate investigation or complex material characterization. Although both deterministic and probabilistic approaches can take into account these uncertainties, the drawback that remains is the difficulty to define an acceptable level of risk. There have been a number of research studies in the past investigating the reliability and the risk level, and some of them are highlighted here. The methodology is quite simple, consisted of graphical correlation between several key parameters. The deterministic and probabilistic analysis are employed through the factor of safety, probability of failure, and the reliability index. These parameters are relatively easy to obtain using today's software for slope stability analysis. Regarding the hazard index, an original rating system is proposed. I will briefly go through all of these parameters. The factor of safety represents the balance of the resisting and driving forces, and if the obtained value is greater than the allowable value, then there is no risk for activation of the sliding mechanism. However, this can lead to some misconception about the overall stability, since the allowable safety factor does not reflect the degree of uncertainty of the input parameters. Therefore, it is not always clear which value should be referent, and it depends on many factors and conditions. In this study, the concept of the traditional factor of safety has been extended through the theory of probability and reliability, often called reliability-based design. The fundamental difference is that the uncertainty of parameters is quantified through a probability distribution function. The probability of failure is the ratio between the number of analyses with safety factor less than one and the total number of analyses in percents, while the reliability index is an indication of the number of standard deviation, which separate the mean factor of safety from the critical factor of safety, using either a normal or log normal distribution of the results. The proposed system, rating system for the hazards is a modified version of the rockfall hazard rating system by Pearson and Van Wickel. The categories like ditch effectiveness, average vehicle risk, percent of decision site distance, roadway width including paved shoulders, and volume of rockfall event and rockfall history are replaced with type of road, slope angle, geological strength index, and measures for protection. All of the categories are relatively easy to obtain, and although the system is based on an individual grading, the only subjective parameter is the geological strength index. This is the table of the proposed rating system. It has eight categories: type of road, slope height, slope angle, structural condition of joint systems, GSI, underground water conditions, climate conditions, and measures for protection. This is the rating of the categories, and the maximum rating points are 100. I should emphasize that the slope height and the slope angle refer to the general global height of the slope and general angle of the slope. The case study, the research area consists of 53 cut slopes on the route from the city of Kičevo to the city of Ohrid in Macedonia. This motorway is under construction for several years with slope stability problems. The majority of the cuts are with heights of more than 30 meters, and several of the cuts are even higher than 100 meters. Generally, the subject location is composed of pilot sericite schists, quartz sericite schists, and graphitic schists. The subject anisotropic rocks are highly weathered, tectonically disturbed, and often folded, which means that the rock formations are very prone to failure. The positive aspect in terms of stability is the foliation, which is dipping to the hill. You can see some of the parameters like rock quality designation index, geological strength index, and the uniaxial compressive strength of the subject rock masses. And below there is a panoramic view of approximately 2 kilometer long section of this motorway. There is a short video in the lower right corner recorded 2 years ago with a drone where we can see the condition on some of the cuts. The picture in the background shows a typical cut section for which an engineering geological cross section will be displayed briefly. As we can see, the foliation is favorable. However, the material is often folded and there are relatively many faults. 53 cuts are part of the database analyzed in this study, from which 23 of the cuts have experienced some significant failure. 15 of the cuts have experienced some local insignificant failure, and 15 of the cuts are stable without visible deformations. Some representative cuts are shown on the picture on the left side of the slide. The first row shows cuts with global failure. The second row shows cuts with local failure in the form of wedges. Interesting for this particular cut under D, there is a video recorded by one of the workers at the time of the failure, from where we can see how bad the material is. The slope here is approximately 10 meters high. Some of the main parameters of the representative cuts regarding type of rock and geometry of the slopes are shown in table two. The third row picture shows cuts with insignificant local deformation, and the bottom row of pictures shows stable cuts without visible deformation. The software rock science slide was used for the slope stability analysis. The deterministic analysis were conducted with non-circular slip surfaces using the method of Morgenstern-Price. The material was modeled according to the generalized Hook-Brown criterion. In the probabilistic analysis, a Monte Carlo sampling method was used, and a global minimum type of analysis, which means that the critical slip surface calculated with the deterministic method was used. The uniaxial compressive strength, the geological strength index, and the material constant MI were used as random variables, and you can see the range of variation of these random variables input parameters. In table 3, there is a summary of the results from the slope stability analysis. And when we see closer at the results, especially for the cuts with where failure has occurred, which were initially stable, the safety factor is higher than 1, the reliability index is less than 2, and probability of failure less than 10%. The hazard rating of these cuts with red number, with red color, there are number of the cuts which belong to a particular category. We can see that most of the cuts have high hazard classification. This is mainly due to the road category and unusual slope height, but also due to the low values of the geological strength index, the unfavorable climate conditions, and the lack of measures for protection. A summary of the results is graphically shown on the presented charts using mutual correlations between the values of the factor of safety, probability of failure, reliability index, and hazard index for all 53 cut slopes, which are part of this study. The red dots represent the cuts with failure, the blue dots represent the cuts with minor deformation, and the green dots represent the stable cuts with no visible deformation. The position of the dots actually represents the level of risk for the analyzed cuts. This is the idea behind this methodology. It is obvious that for the cut slopes with failures, the level of risk is not acceptable. For the cut slopes with minor deformations, the level of risk defines a conditionally acceptable scenario, which means the risk can be tolerated. For the slopes with no visible deformations, the level of risk should be acceptable. Boundary lines are fitted on the charts, distinguishing the cut slopes with failures from those with minor deformation and those without deformation. These zones represent referent levels on the long-term risk for cut slopes in highly weathered schists, and determine if the level of risk is acceptable, conditionally acceptable, or unacceptable. Although we do not have comprehensive data to construct the lines from the beginning to the end of the graphs, the lines are logically extended following the recommendations from literature for the referent values of the key parameters. Those are the dashed zones of the lines. According to the conclusions from the previous slide, this is the final product, the novel charts for risk evaluation of cut slopes in highly weathered schists. All diagrams have referent zones representing the level of risk for the analyzed rock slope. The first zone indicates that the level of risk is not acceptable. This means that the safety standards are far from being satisfied and there should be a new design for the slope. If the cut slope is located in the second zone, which defines a conditionally acceptable level of risk, it means that the risk can be tolerated. The third zone highlights an acceptable level of risk where most of the case scenario should be located, defining an optimal level of safety. This means that the design standards are satisfied and at the same time, the solution is not over-designed. The fourth zone shows an over-designed cut slope indicating a minimized level of risk to the extent where the solution is economically unacceptable. It is recommended to use all 5 diagrams and adopt either the least favorable case scenario or the majority, 3 out of 5 with identical zones. Some concluding remarks at the end. It is very difficult to define the exact geotechnical parameters of a particular rock slope, which will represent the entire zone of interest. Therefore, it is not recommended to rely exclusively on deterministic analysis because we can misjudge the stability and experience problems in the exploitation phase. The problem should be analyzed with the theory of probability and estimate the hazard also to get a complete picture of the stability and level of risk. The reduction of the risk leads to an expensive solution, while a higher risk level may jeopardize the stability. This was actually the motivation and hopefully the contribution of this study to define a methodology which will help designers to make a balance between safety and economy. In the presented case study, all 53 cut slopes were redesigned following this methodology to meet the acceptable level of risk. And until now, all of the cut slopes are stable with very few visible deformations. The presented charts can be used in other highly weathered rock formations or rock with weak parameters. Next steps of this research are verification of these results with more advanced models for rock characterization and upgrading the charts with results from slope stability along discontinuities. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
So thank you very much for your interesting presentation. And now we have the second presentation of this section, which is given by Dr. Miano. The title is Remote Sensing Data to Support the Structural Monitoring or RC Buildings Affected by Ground Instability Phenomena. Please, Dr. Miano.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm going to share the screen. Okay, may you see my screen?
Yes, Andrea.
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, so good morning to everyone. I'm Andrea Miano from the Department of Structure for Engineering and Architecture of University of Naples Federico II. Today I'm going to present the work with title Remote Sensing Data to Support the Structural Monitoring of RC Buildings Affected by Ground Instability Phenomena. The motivation for such a work is that the building stock around the world is exposed to different types of natural action, such as landslides. And Italy is one of the countries worldwide most affected by this type of natural action. So this moves our research, and the mitigation of landslide risk is a topic of big interest, with specific focusing on the assessment and management of their consequences on the building and infrastructures, in particular in urban areas. Then we had some highlights from this work, and the fundamental highlights are the following ones. This work shows a structural health monitoring process for an RC infilled building affected by ground instability phenomena by analyzing the progression of damage through DINSAR and structural data. And then the proposed methodology uses the available displacements from satellite data at the ground columns of the building as input for the structural analysis, with the goal to have a damage prediction through the years. Let's start with our methodology. And the first ingredient of this methodology is the differential SAR interferometry approach. The SAR, the synthetic aperture radar, is an instrument and a technique which uses signal processing to improve the resolution beyond the limitation of physical antenna aperture. It consists in an active sensor which generates electromagnetic waves and detects the echo of the waves from object. The main features of the SAR are the amplitude and the phase, where the amplitude is the measure of the strength of a signal and the phase is the angle of a complex number. And this are the parameters, the key parameters for arriving to the ground surface deformation that are really important for structural application. So the DINSAR techniques allow to compare two or more different images to obtain topographic measurement or identify ground surface displacement. Clearly, these measurements can be associated to a path of stress strain ongoing on the case study structure. Then this is very important for our investigation. The targets of this technique can be everywhere and can be part of buildings, part of infrastructures, outcropping rocks. Every object that can reflect the signal can be monitored. Clearly, the satellite moves along two orbits. So there is an ascending orbit and an descending orbit. And it is possible for each target to monitor the velocity or displacement time history. For example, here we may see some of the monitored points with this technique. And for one point in ascending orbit and one point in descending orbit, we can see the time history of the displacement. The second ingredient to complete this work of structural earth monitoring is the structural analysis and the damage assessment. The inter-story drift value corresponding to the achievement of a certain damage state has been directly associated to the inter-story drift value related to the peak load of the infill experimental response. We have to say that in this work, we have focused our attention on the infills because we monitored the building that presented some problems, some failures only in the infills. But a similar procedure can be repeated, for example, for masonry structure or for RC structure but analyzing the columns and the beams. Then we have four damage states that we have identified. And this is very important for the progress of the work. We have the DS1 that is light cracking. We have DS2 that is extensive cracking. We have DS3 that is corner crashing and DS4 that is the collapse. Clearly, these damage states are one more problematic than the other with the progression of the numbers. So it means that DS1 is the one with the lower problem and the DS4 is the collapse of the infill that is clearly a situation of big risk also for the people who lives in the building. Then we arrive to a flowchart of the wall procedure. On the left side, we have the satellite input data. We start from discrete point maps that are transformed then in continuous maps. Then by combining the information from the two data set, we can arrive to the displacement components in terms of displacement clearly, along the horizontal east-west direction and along the vertical direction. Clearly, using this component of displacement allows us to make a more precise and refined structural analysis. On the other side, in order to perform a structural analysis, we need some structural input data from the case study. So we need some in-situ survey with geometry and material identification and damage detection. Then clearly we have a part of simulated design to understand also some properties that cannot be detected with simple surveys. And we have a 3D structural modeling that is another very important moment of the analysis. Then we arrive to the structural analysis. We apply these displacement profiles that I have described at the basis of the column. We have the definition of the damage state that we have seen before, and then we can compare the analytical prevision obtained with this model and observe the damage that we have found during the in-situ survey. Then can be done a global structural assessment of the building, and clearly under certain condition, it is possible to do also a future prediction of the damage. Clearly, this prediction of the damage in the future has an high grade of uncertainty and can be interpreted only as a preliminary prevision, because clearly the condition can change and it is not written that the trend of the displacement should be the same in a certain amount of following years. Let's come to the case study area description. So we have applied this procedure to a case study. We talk about the built-up area of Moio della Civitella that develops on the slope of Mount Sacro in the Cilento Vallo di Diana and Alburni National Park. The territory is widely affected by several slow-moving and intermittent rainfall-induced landslide due to lithologic, structural, hydrogeologic, and geomorphologic settings. The investigated building is interested by a flow-type movement earth flow classified in 2012 as dormant. The structure is an independent structure with a rectangular plan of 11.6 by 12.1 meters, built on three levels and consisting of orthogonal RC frames. Visual inspection revealed the presence of different types of masonry infills on the ground floor. Now, the original design documents relating to the building were not available, then the authors have implemented a simulated design. This simulated design is very important because allow to fill the lack of knowledge regarding the structural elements when it is not possible to reach accurate knowledge of the structure by consultation of original document or site surveys. Clearly, we move to the modeling description. Once the characteristic of the main elements were defined, a structural model has been created using the finite element method software SAP 2000. Beams and columns have been modeled as frame elements. The mechanical behavior of this element has been modeled through a concentrated plasticity model, considering the nonlinear flexural behavior at the end of the members. Clearly, for the infills, instead, an equivalent strut model has been used. Now we have the SAR discrete data. Here we may see the loss displacement velocity maps of target identified within the area of Moio della Civitella. On the left side, we see the ascending targets, and on the right side, we see the descending targets. All the points monitored are shown in this figure. The color of the points represent the amount of velocity expressed in millimeter over years. The velocity shown is in line of sight of the satellite, so it's not the component, vertical or horizontal, but is measured in line of sight of the satellite. Again, here, with the same idea, we have the points, but now the points that are related only to the analyzed building registered by Cosmos SkyMed data, so the targets that are obtained. Again, the color showed the different values of the velocity of the deformation expressed in millimeter over years. Now we arrive to the cumulative displacement maps along vertical and horizontal east-west direction. So we took that point, we used an interpolation, we combined the interpolated data, and we arrived to the component. Here you may see the plan of the building put on side on the top of the maps. It is to note that there are many interpolation techniques that can be used. A deterministic method is herein used to determine the continuous maps from which extract the displacement profiles under the case study building. These are the displacement profile affecting the building foundation at the end of each year in the period 2012-2016. You may see that for each side of the building, we have the displacement profile. Inside the structural model, we applied this displacement and we found the corresponding stress strain configuration that is present inside the building after the application of this displacement. In order to make a comparison between those observed damage and the analytical prediction, we start with the identification of the crack pattern at the infills in 2015. We have the northwest side, the wall on the northwest side, and the wall on the southeast side. On the northwest side, we have that generally, globally, we have a level of damage to extensive cracking with variable crack widths. While on the southeast wall, we have only a perimeteral infill that is interested by corner crushing. But this corner crushing was already existing in 2011, means before the application of the displacement profile. This means that we cannot detect it with our analysis. Establishing from the analysis the intersolid drift related to each infills of interest, it has been possible to identify this value on the capacity curve of the infill. Then, according to the Cardone-Perrone and the Risi model and drift limits, it has been possible to identify the damage state for each infill and for each year of the analysis. Herein, it is shown at 2015 in order to make a direct comparison with the observed damage. So we have the condition at 2015, and we may see here the analytical prediction. Then clearly it is possible to move to the comparison between the damage states classification based on empirical observation and obtained by analytical prediction. Globally, it works. Clearly, the goal of this work is not to identify a complete correspondence of these two parameters, also because there are many parameters in the game, and we have to consider that the more the information we have from in situ survey, the more we can be precise. But this type of analysis can be useful in the scenario of civil protection plans. After this, a global assessment of the building has been done with the prediction of number of infills that have reached a certain damage state divided by floor and evaluated in 2016. Clearly, we may see that each year the number of failing infills increases. Then we do a prevision of the number of infills that will reach a certain damage state in 2025 divided by floor. Clearly, as I said, this has a grade of uncertainty and then can be interpreted only as a preliminary prevision. In conclusion, this work shows a structural earth monitoring process for an RC infillet building affected by ground instability phenomena by analyzing the progression of the damage through the INSAR and structural data. The proposed methodology uses the available displacement from satellite data at the ground columns of the building as input for structural analysis. The aim of the work is to demonstrate the potential utility of the INSAR satellite data to support the structural health monitoring of RC buildings affected, in this case, by landslide. The evidence of a visual survey after 4 years of monitoring showed a significant damage pattern in some infills. And then a good agreement has been found between the analytical prevision and existing damage pattern for the infills, of which clearly a visual survey existed, showing the potential use of the remote sensing technique data in order to make a preliminary structural assessment. Finally, assuming a constant increasing of the displacement in future years based on the result of a linear regression obtained with the available data, a preliminary prediction of the future expected damage has been shown. Thank you for the attention.
Oh, okay, thank you very much, Dr. Miano. Now we have the third presentation of this section given by Dr. De Stefano.
Hi. Can you see me?
Yes.
Can you see my screen?
See? Okay.
So, good afternoon to everyone. I'm Rita De Stefano, PhD student at the Department of Earth Science at the University of Federico II in Naples. Today, I'd like to share with you our first result on our work on integrated analysis system for the design of risk mitigation works in collaboration with Sintema Engineering, spin-off of Federico II University of Naples, the Department of Engineering of University of Cassino and Department of Engineering of University of Naples. So the main purpose of the present work has been the study of slope stability bordering the hamlet of Calonia, combining the integration of the conventional remote sensing techniques in order to plan risk mitigation intervention. The area study is located along the southern ionic side of the Calabria region in southern of Italy, and is located on a relict Miocene surface in northwest-southwest direction, with an altitude about 300 meters above sea level, and is characterized by a subvertical slope of about 35 meters. From a geological point of view, it rises on a Miocene subsection of vericolor clay at the base, superimposed by a stratigraphic count from sequences of conglomerate, sandstone, and pellets. The conglomerates are generally exposed along the edge of the cliff, and in particular in the northwestern side of the city, are sometimes in a sandy matrix, while in the southeast part prevails the clay component with intercalation of silt and sandstone. At the base, Calonia is characterized by gravelly sandy of recent and ancient landslide body. The morphological aspect is there that linked to the present geological condition, so a stratigraphic model can be simplified as follows. A flat top zone consisting on conglomerate and silt lenses that rests on a vericolor clay with a different level of weathering. In this case, the circulation occurs by fracturing from the conglomerates, while the level of weathering in the clay are about 5-6 meters. This particular condition can create a landslide phenomenon that, according to Cruden and Van classification, are classified as fall and slide. In fact, as shown in cartography of Inventory Italian Landslide IF project, we can see that Calonia territory territory, there are several types of landslide phenomena classified as fall in southwest sector, slide in the southeast sector, while complex airflow in the other part of the edge of the cliff. So according to the cartography of Southern Apennines District Basin Authority, we can see that the entire Calonia site falls in very high risk index. From the study of bibliographic and historical data from the study of Prevesnitsa et al. In 1995, the area is characterized by a slope retreat phenomena since the 1783 earthquake. So the authors proposed a geological model rupture that better explained the evolution of the processes. It all starts from the instability of upper layer vericolor clay that create a particular instability condition also in the overlaying conglomerates in the upper part through the fracturing. This particular condition can create a rototranslational phenomena with a change of the slope, angle slope of the slope. So at the end of the processes, the slope returns in its initial configuration. So the cycle repeats itself from the phase one to the phase four. And the main trigger factors that create this instability are due to not only to instability of upper layer vericolor clay, but also to extreme events like earthquakes and flood. So in order to identify the extent of phenomena and the most effective risk mitigation planning, we are carried out an integrated analysis with the remote sensing, direct and indirect survey, in addition to a bibliographic study and geological field survey to better reconstruct the geological model of the area. In particular, were carried out 5 boroughs, 2 geoelectrical profile, 1 georadar survey, visual inspection and inter analysis. In order to detect deformation in a large area, Cosmos schematic image in descending geometry were processed with the INSAR technique. In a period from April 2015 to April 2020. The INSAR technique is an efficient technique in this case, overall before planning the investigation and intervention. In addition, urban areas are the best context for these techniques thanks to the high natural reflector like buildings or rocks. So the results show that the major displacement occurs in southwestern part of the urban center with a displacement of 15 centimeters. So in this area, we decided to concentrate the direct investigation. In detail, 5 soundings were carried out, 4 continuous, 1 inclined and 1 destructive. Reaching a maximum depth of 33 meters. A geological model of surface was reconstructing by passing a section through S8, S1, S2 boroughs. So how can we see? Caledonia Cliff is characterized in the upper part by alternation of pelitic lithophases and conglomeratic lithophases that resist on a very color clay, and the upper layer very color clay are characterized by gravelly sandy and sandy clay of the detrital deposit. The geoelectrical investigation identified the presence of 2 main electro layers. The first one is shallow, the first one, with a low resistivity, while in depth with a high value of resistivity. And the trend appears sometimes discontinuous to the presence of small cavities. Small cavity are shown also in georadar survey. With the aim to monitoring the kinematic characteristic of the slope, the S2 borehole was conditioned by an inclinometer for a length of 15 meters. So the first elaboration show a shallow movement in the first 4 meters from the ground floor, corresponding to the clay sandy deposit and gray green clay clays. While S3 borehole was conditioned by a Casagrande type piezometer and showed that the groundwater level varies from 2 meters to 2.5 meters. At the end, visual inspections were carried out by specialized rock geologists in order to verify the erosion of the condition of the exposed fronts. So a total of 10 wrappers were carried out during which it was possible to note the presence of detachment in the conglomerate lithophases. And in particular, the major detachment are result during the 1, 2, 5, 6 wrappers. So in conclusion, the main purpose was the study of stability of the slope bordering the urban area of Caledonia. As we could see, the area is characterized by several landslides due to its geological and geomorphological assets, such as fall and sliding. So thanks to first to large area analysis, we can say that the major deformation occurs in southern part of Caledonia. So in this area, we concentrate the detailed geological survey. And we can say that the subsoil of the area is characterized on an alternation of conglomeratic sandy deposit in the upper part that resting on a clay substratum with a different level of weathering. On the other hand, during the geological field survey, was noted that the greatest stability is found in conglomeratic portion, and the evidence of landslide movement are evident in the historical center through damages in the urban center, in the main square of the city, and on the buildings. So the complexity of phenomena are due to main two main causes. The first one is anthropic, due to the non-exhaustive water disposal system in the city that create small cavities in the paleolithic formation due to the washout of this portion of to the paleolithic formation. The other end, we have a natural causes due to the stability of alterated vericolor clay that create a landslide phenomenon and the stability of conglomerates in the upper part of the city. For this reason, the next step is to guarantee the risk mitigation to reduce the phenomena of stability along the most exposed fronts, reduce the occurrence of small cavity, and reduce the stability below the cliff in the vericolor clay. Anyway, we will continue with the satellite monitoring to verify the status of intervention, also through the installation of a corner reflector in order to compare satellite monitoring results with the in-situ monitoring instrumental results. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much for your presentation, Dr. De Stefano. And I think that at this point, we could pass to the discussion. And I remember that this discussion will refer to the last, the 3.2 section, but will include also the discussion about the special lecture given by Claudio Margottini. At this point, I give the word or the microphone to the convener of this section, Professor Federica Cotecchia. Federica.
Thank you. Yes, this has been another interesting session dealing with how living in these highly unstable territories with very complex setups, difficult to diagnose, and how difficult it is in particular to deal with these large, vast areas or otherwise small scale problems where when you have to deal with several landslides, as is the case for with the presentation of Dr. Janevski.
It's possible to address a question also to Professor Scarpelli because we had
yes I was going to say
okay,
this
thank you
and now I will ask I've got to know only half an hour ago that the persons can ask the question also directly if the online connection is activated for the panelists. So I asked to Dr. Comegna whether this is still the case. I would like people to ask directly the question. Otherwise, I will read them. And I invite the audience also to ask questions to Professor Scarpelli and Margottini, because I suppose that this is the discussion time also for the special lectures.
Right.
Is it possible, Luca, to connect to the people with the people asking the question, or shall I read them?
If they want to address a question live, it is possible to activate the webcam. The yes. panelists, the webcam of the panelists are always activated now. But also if from the audience, someone could express to address question live, is possible. So just...
There is a question from Francesco Cafaro and yes. one question from Roberto Vassallo. They could be activated.
Yes,
and,
they could activate.
And I have to say another thing. I mean, I read the questions in due time during the presentation. There were a few questions to Dr. Janevski then probably have been replied, but maybe it's of interest for the audience to know about the reply. So Francesco Cafaro or Roberto Vassallo, they are connected. Okay, I give the word to Francesco Cafaro.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, Francesco.
Yeah, I ask it to
Janeski.
Yes. How he quantified the uncertainty of the input parameters related to undersampling fundamentally.
Well, I answered, but I will repeat it. This is the exact reason why the most of the instabilities occurred, because before there were used only deterministic analysis with fixed values of the parameters. When you don't have comprehensive data, quantitative and qualitative investigations, you use what you have. So maybe it's wiser to use some wider variation of these parameters to be safe.
Okay, but the information about the spatial variability of the rock, of the soil, is present in your maps?
Sorry?
The information concerning the spatial variability of the soil is present in your maps directly or indirectly?
Which maps?
Hazard maps.
I don't understand.
I mean, how did you take account of the spatial variability of the mechanical parameters in yes. your analysis, in your charts? Maybe the word was charts rather than maps.
Your charts, yes.
Well, it's the in situ conditions of the cuts. The results in conjunction with the in situ results show either the cut is stable or not. I don't know if I can respond.
No, the question is whether the type of the type of rock is clear, whether there was a chance to implement the mechanical parameters. I assume that Francesco Cafaro was meaning this, if they were entering in the processing.
The charts directly?
No, in the processing, in the processing.
The processing of the data.
Resulted in your charts.
Yes, they were involved in the analysis.
Okay. Okay, they were input in the analysis. Okay.
Okay.
Now I give the word to Roberto Vassallo for a question to Dr. Miano.
Yes, to Andrea Miano. I don't know if you already read my question. Anyway, if I understood correctly, you used ascending and descending orbit data to estimate different components of displacements along the satellite lines of sight from one side and the other side, and then you reconstructed the displacement vectors. So my question was if the different movements of the different points on the buildings that you detected were mainly due to deformations, or there was a significant part of rigid rotation? Because you know, in other cases, frequently you don't have both the ascending and descending data to tell that. So what was there in your case?
Okay, many thanks for the question. I have to say that in our case, we considered a very low rise building. So there is no a big effect of the points at different quotes of the buildings. This, in our interpretation, the point, the deformation that we saw at the basis of the building are the settlements, and whatever the settlements have recorded, we applied to the structure in order to understand the stress strain deformation inside the structure. So without considering any rigid rotation phenomena directly, in the sense that for us, for me, that I see it from a structural point of view, in with the goal of understanding what can happen inside the structural mechanism of failure, I interpreted these displacement profiles at the ground as an input, as the action. So whatever is the answer of the structure, can be rigid rotation, can be single wall mechanism, are the result of the application of this displacement in the structure. This is the main concept, but clearly I would say that there is no consideration of the rigid movements of the buildings.
And also no, there is no consideration of horizontal deformation. I mean, it's just considered as vertical displacement.
Not only vertical, also horizontal deformation, but only in the east-west direction, because the satellite can read only the east-west component. So it is clear that this is a very important point. If the building, for example, the wall is oriented around the north-south, this means that the deformation inside the plane of the wall cannot be seen, while we can see very well the deformation once it is oriented in the east-west direction. Clearly, another important aspect to be highlighted is that from a structural point of view, the failure mechanism associated to a vertical settlement are somehow different from what happened with horizontal displacement and settlement, because there are some type of verification, for example, regarding the joints or the infill that respond in a different way based on the application of this vertical or horizontal displacement.
There are several questions to Dr. Miano. I give the word.
I'm happy about it.
I give the word to Dario Peduto.
Yes, thank you, Federica. I want to congratulate with your work. It's very interesting, Dr. Miano. I have just one curiosity, and I would like, from another aspect, a comment from you. The curiosity is from the structural point of view. How did you take into account as we know, the permanent scatters are at the roof level, and during your analysis, I think that you put these data as a settlement at the level of the foundation, if I'm not wrong. So did you have an idea of how much this can affect your results? Because these are measurements at the roof level and you are considering them at the foundation level. This is the first question. Then just a comment from you, in order to highlight how, since you are talking about a procedure that can have, of course, can be exported at the urban scale you mentioned, I would like to understand, in your opinion, which could be the parameters, the simplification that we could assume, we could take in order to export these, the case of the single building to other buildings, because I think that could be, let's say, the main goal of this kind of analysis. Otherwise, we should carry out the classical geotechnical structural analysis. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the question. I have to say that there are two very interesting questions, so I will excuse, but I need a little bit of time to respond to them.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's start from the first one. The point is very good, because from a structural point of view, we should just take into account, in a very accurate response, only the ground measurements, because clearly what happened in the roof has also the contribution of what happens in the structure. So it's not the same, clearly. We had some points also at the ground. We have a consistent amount of points at the ground in this case. We used also the roof level points because our building is a low-rise building. So we estimate that in a case in which there is a low rise building, we can do this simplification, but I mentioned this is a simplification, and in a precise approach, I would prefer to use also only the ground points. Clearly, now there are a number of satellites that is increasing with the years. Also, the number of reading of the satellite is increasing. So I would expect for the future also to relieve more points. And in a precise approach, I would suggest to compare, as it is, it has been done in this case. However, the topography of the points with the digital elevation model, in order to clearly put the points at the ground and only considering only these points. Another thing that can be done is to read the difference between the roof points and the ground points. This is directly related to what happened in the structure. For example, if I have a drift between the same point and the same planimetric level between a ground point and a roof point, I can interpret it with some structural consideration. So this was absolutely a needed clarification to be done. About the second point, when we go to an urban scale, clearly it is not possible to have a structural relief of all the buildings, because clearly it means that we should go in each building to understand the geometrical configuration, to understand which are the points associated to the facade of the buildings, because these are the points at the ground level that can be used. One thing that can be done is to just use some simplified relief of the building. For example, there are some regional maps that shows only in plan the position of the building. Without entering in the displacement time history evaluation, we can do some consideration about the velocity. If I have a group of buildings and I see that in some of them there is a point that show a change in the slope of the velocity, I could argue that something is happening on that building. So I can say, okay, let's go to monitor this building. It's like a preliminary assessment of what can happen in an urban system. But I cannot say that we can do automatically a structural assessment. We can just make a warning.
Early okay. detection, you mean?
Yes, yes. This is the main concept.
Okay. There is a question from Claudia Vitone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I have a question for Dr. Miano and a curiosity for De Stefano. Thank you for your presentation. It was very, very interesting. I would ask you, I was wondering to know same things that Dario asked you. So, but I would like to understand better. In this case, you performed some numerical analysis, nonlinear numerical analysis on the structure, 3D, and also based on simulated design, so just from this visual inspection of the building. So I would like to know again how, if in your opinion, this is affordable for a first level method, so a method to be used for a town scale, so a urban scale. Also because on the other hand, we do not have, as far as I could understand, any information about the foundations or soil mechanical characteristics and so on. So this is a point that I would like to stress. So there is a very unbalanced approach from structural side to the geotechnical side. So I would like to understand what is your opinion on this point.
And okay. May I respond now or?
Oh yeah.
Yes, yes.
Okay, okay. Many thanks for the question. Okay, also here the question should be discussed in depth because it's a very important point. If we think to an urban scale monitoring, I'm sure that in this approach, it is missed the part of the subsoil investigation, because we need to know which are the soil characteristics and where the foundation of the building is in which in which level of the subsoils, because in this way we can make some judgment, preliminary judgment, on the possibility of the on the possibility of relate also this displacement with some literature damage scale that correlate the damage with the displacement measurements. There are some limits in literature based also on the consideration of the subsoil. The focus of this work is it from our point of view, since it is a first work in this type of research field, it was to investigate if, assuming the ground displacement as an input, the structural modeling based on this ground displacement can more or less find an agreement with the observed damage. But considering an urban scale monitoring, it is clear that some geological section above the building is needed to complete the analysis.
Well, actually, I mean, the number of works dealing with this problem are becoming numerous in the literature at the urban scale and at the building scale. And it's very difficult often to diagnose whether there are landslide settlements or not. So probably this aspect is also impacting. There are questions to De Stefano, I understand. Bitone mentioned one.
Yes, just a curiosity, Dr. De Stefano. I have seen that you have some varicolor clays or some fissured clays, I guess, in your site. So I would like to know if you have also some information about the intrinsic weakness of these materials that can represent a prompting for the instability phenomena. So some information about the geomechanics of the at least clay strata in your site.
Yeah, thank you for your question. At, we are in a preliminary part of the study. So in the next time we will proceed to an integrated analysis. So also in geotechnical analysis to better know the behavior of the varicolor clay and the other lithophases that are in the area. So at the moment we know that the subsoil are constituted by conglomerates in the upper part and the varicolor clay at the bottom, and so we are the next step are to investigate better from the geotechnical point of view these materials.
I know there is a question from Dr. Santaloia to De Stefano.
Okay.
You can speak, yeah.
Yes. Hi. Good afternoon. I would like to ask two questions concerning the landslide causes, the causes of the landslide shown by Dr. De Stefano. Firstly, as I see from your presentation, the landslide mechanism seems to be deeply connected to the geological structure, geological setting of the slope, and so from the presence of the scaly clay at the bottom of the slope overlain by the conglomerate. I've seen that you have demonstrated, shown also in a slope evolution of the failure process, but it's not so clear to me if it's initiated at the bottom of the slope where the scaly clay outcrop and progressing upslope. So if it's this, the slope evolution, or also in the other set that the failure begins at the top and progresses downslope, I would like to know if you have understood the reason why, so the causes of the first, of the triggering of this landslide. Okay, this is very important. It's connected to what is connected, which are the causes. This is the first question. The second question is, as you've shown, the landslide debris is not so deep, is very shallow. You have shown an inclinometer of 4 meters above the depth. I would like to know, and as also you said that the current activity is connected to rainfall and also to the water upslope infiltrated along the conglomerate. But I would like to know, have you studied also in which term the rainfall influences the landslide activity? So which type of rainfall is the single events or the cumulative event? If you have studied also the real in deep, the influence of rainfall on the activity of these landslides that border the hamlet, the promontory. I hope that is clear, my two questions, the first one and the second one.
Okay, thank you for your question. For the first question, the problems, the landslide triggering are, as I said, are anthropic and natural. Anthropic because the non-exhaustive water disposal system in the upper part of the city create a washout in the lithic formation, so the shallow formation that are above the conglomeratic lithophases. But conglomeratic lithophases is characterized by a fracture. So another triggering factor is also the rainfall that the circulation occurs by fracturing in the conglomerates and create the stability of the block in the upper part. The other causes is due to also the stability of the weathering, level of weathering in the over the vericolor clay that we say is not so thickness, about 5-6 meters. So, and also in this case, the rainfall with the long rainfall creates a instability also in at the bottom, but the stability at the bottom can create also the stability in the upper part. I don't know if it's clear.
Thank you.
Yes.
I give the word to Professor Di Maio. Was a question for Professor Scarpelli. I don't know if Caterina Di Maio can connect.
Ah, yes, perfect. I'm here. So yes, a question for Pino Scarpelli.
Yes.
Pino, do you think that the current standard NETC 2018 are satisfactory, sufficient for the stability analysis problems, above all in seismic conditions, or they need to be improved?
Well, that's a question which extends the my presentation from European code of practice to national standards, which so it's a bit different. I would say yes. The present standard, national standard, allows the concept of an ongoing stability of the landslides of on a slope in general during during seismic events, allowing the possibility for irreversible deformations to be caused by the earthquake. And in a way, this is quite strange for national technical codes, where we always are based on the concept of the safety factor. So you really need to show that even under seismic condition, the safety factor must be larger than one, with all the assumptions about shear strength properties of the material, and which are generally very conservative and so on. So the idea that during earthquakes, slopes can be considered as an acceptable condition, even if there would be some irreversible displacement, it is a very modern way of considering the state of this slope in that particular conditions. Obviously, this move from the old concept of the safety factor to the modern concept of considering what will be the amount of displacement which will be suffered by the slope during the earthquake. And this gives to designer a quite difficult task, because as you can imagine, common designers, common practitioners are not really accustomed to more complex analysis like we in academics we try to do. So I would say yes, the answer is yes. I think the national, the NTC 2008 is a good standard from that point of view. And I think that more than that must be used rather than this possibility, rather than change it.
I have a question for you, Pino, but this is a very general question. Considering how your presentation shows how complex is the design of new projects and developments in hilly areas full of landslides, often are not recognized landslides while construction is even already on. I'm not referring to the NTC, but rather also to the national code defining how to the financial distribution of the support with respect to the diagnosis of the slopes versus how the cost of the construction, the cost of the monitoring, etc. So, I mean, what we call in Italian codice degli appalti, whereas, I mean, I don't know the translation. Maybe you know how to translate this in English. There is enough attention devoted financially, I mean, to the diagnosis part, of the territory and of the slopes interacting with the new opera, with the new construction, according to you, or the fact that the diagnosis is often not well developed is also due to the way the money is distributed for the different aspects of the construction.
Good question, actually, difficult to answer. Question of the money distribution. Well, really, I don't think that is a problem of the distribution, because if you look at the very end, the costs of the damage you can cause without for not a good investigation, as we have learned this morning from the beautiful lecture we received, it's much bigger than
exactly
than what we do. It's a problem of is a cultural problem. In general, owners do not like to spend money at the very beginning in investigation. I think that is a common problem in every country. I would say in Europe is very, very common problem. But there is more freedom in the development of the design procedures to adjust the design in order to account for the increasing knowledge during the increasing numbers of investigations. I think there is a more open mind to that. And the problem that the countries comes when the laws are so strict that becomes very difficult to make any change in the planning of the expenditure during the adjustment of the different solutions, which is very difficult to manage into the contract. And the problem for our country specifically is that any mistake in that sense, it becomes a penal law, a violation of the penal law rather than a violation of the contract. So the big difference is that one, is that we should try to depenalize the errors, which can come the errors. I mean, designers can make mistakes during the development, but they can correct if they have the opportunity to do that. But if the change of any design procedures becomes something to discuss for avoid penalties, then it is difficult for every part in the contract to sincerely arrive to the right solution, because everybody starts to try to protect himself. So I don't think it's really is a problem of money, but I think it's a problem of the way in which contracts, so the code Codice Appalti, I don't know how to translate that.
That's a problem.
It's not my common English at the moment, really. But anyway, it's difficult to, the difficulties come from there rather than from the way in which the money is actually assigned.
Okay.
Don't know whether answer to that.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I don't see any other questions in the slot.
I have a question. I have one question to Janevski and a curiosity for De Stefano. Please. Yes, for Janevski, I have lost something, but I don't understand how did you fix the range of variation of the geotechnical parameters? So did you do a geotechnical survey to fix the range of variation? Because I didn't see in your presentation.
Yes, thank you for your question. The range of variation of the random variables, the input parameters, were according to the results. I didn't have time, but we have synthesized a database from more than 1,000 samples of these rocks. So we have a lot of data from laboratory and in situ results.
On which you could build up, so the statistical distribution. So
statistical variation was
variation. Thanks Thank for you. Your reply. And yes, I have a curiosity for De Stefano.
Please. Yes, Marianna.
So, De Stefano, thank you for nice presentation. And just a curiosity, according to that you said that one of the causes of the landslides is the rainfall, you are going to measure rainfall at site. And another curiosity, did you do any saturated permeability field test?
Uh,
Thank you for your question. As I said first, at the moment we don't have these results, because the next step is installing the major station.
Okay. And the field measurement of saturated permeability, have you? No, okay. No. Okay. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
I do thank all the participants for the several nice questions and the presenters. And so I suppose I give the word to the professors Piccarelli and Crosta, I suppose.
Yes.
And now,
or to Luca Comegna, I don't know. Yes.
No. Now we have to move to the closure conclusion. Yes. We have to leave this session.
Ah, okay.
And we have to open and join another session.
Thank you.
So thank you a lot to conveners, Professor Federica Cotecchia, and thanks a lot to Chairman Claudio Scava for these two last sessions, and thank to everybody.